being challenged. I'm pretty notorious, I leave my glasses down where I leave them. So if I make any mistakes tonight, it's all because of my glasses. Sister Dietrich packed her clean hers, maybe I'll go borrow hers.
Brother Eli said, "Oh, let me borrow his."
Yeah, do a reading thing.
You think they'd work for me?
Oh, yeah.
Now, hold on, brother. Turn to John chapter number 10. My goal and what we've been trying to do, and I feel like the Lord has helped us, is look at various things throughout the Gospel of John. Even as I said on Sunday, the Gospel of John, I mentioned this on Sunday morning, the Gospel of John becomes so different than all the other Gospels. John writes it in such a different way. Let me just reiterate what I said on Sunday when I was preaching on, because we talked about John 3:16 last week, when I was preaching on Abraham. And where was the first mention, what was mentioned first in the Bible when we find the story of Abraham? Remember what I said on Sunday? What's that word that we find mentioned for the very first time in Genesis chapter number 22 there? Remember? The message was so good, I know.
Was it love?
It was, brother. You're right. Where God told Abraham, take your son, your only son. Was it his only son?
No.
No, he had Ishmael. Whom thou lovest. So God was making lots of distinctions about what he's to do to give that son that he loves. And so I said to you on Sunday that when we see love, Sister Dietrich mentioned in the Bible the first time, we maybe would think about a love of a mother to her children, because we know that that is there. We maybe would think of a love for a man toward his wife. But God uses the first instance in that being that a father is love for a son. And then we come into the New Testament, and Matthew, Mark, and Luke reveal love for the first time as they reveal the baptism of Jesus by John the Baptist. And the Father says, this is my beloved, my son whom I love. Now John breaks the mold. He said, I'm not going to give you the same instance. Remember, he writes the Gospel of John sometime later. He writes it as he's able to look back in retrospect, understand it a little bit better. I tell you what, I would never, ever, 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 ever want to go back and relive a lot of things.
Yeah.
How about it? Yeah. Sister Dietrich, are you wiser than you were 30 years ago?
I hope so.
Me too. No, but I think all of us, we look back at our life experience and we see how God has worked in our life experience, and we say, man, oh, if I would have known then what I know now. And so John sees and he knows, and he shares the love of God in the Son in John 3:16. That's where he first mentions love. And it's all about God sending his only begotten Son. But it's all correlated that God wanted us to know the importance of a father's love for a son, because he loved his only begotten Son whom he sent to die for us. Amen. God loves us. And so, from the very beginning, let me just reiterate a few things. I'm not trying to re-preach Sunday's message. I'm not even going to the same place that I was aiming at on Sunday morning. But remember this, that God had asked of Isaac to give his only son, whom he loved. God loved his son.
Amen.
We find that Abraham is obedient in the giving of his son. God is obedient in the giving of his son for the remission of the sins of the world. Even though he couldn't stand to see it, it grew dark.
Yes.
My God, why hast thou forsaken me? You know, we go through moments in our life where we may feel like we're forsaken by God. But as the writer of Footprints in the Sand says, we look back in that retrospect once again, those are the moments that God carried us. God really didn't leave us. But Jesus was feeling this, and it was so. God could not stand to see his very Son bear upon him the sins of the world. And this is the amazing thing I want us to think about. And it all leads into what we're going to talk about tonight. He also, Brother Eli, before Abraham got up there to the mountain with his son Isaac, and Brother Eli brought this out, and he was 100% right. Whatever Abraham was thinking, he said, my son and I will come back. That's what he said to the servants. He said, you'll stay here. We're going to climb Mount Moriah, which would be later Jehovah Jireh, the place where God provided. He said, you stay here. My son and I will return.
Yeah.
So he felt that either God would raise his son up from the dead. I don't think he had in his mind this idea of a ram being caught in the thicket. I don't think his ideology thought that at all. I do think he probably thought that God could raise him up from the dead, because this is where the promises of God were. He probably thought, you know, all the promises of God, I'm still holding to them. And so, but God knew that he had a substitute already provided long before Abraham and Isaac made his way up the mountain.
Yeah.
God already had a substitute even before the foundation of the world. He already planned for his son to come and give his life. Talk about the redemptive plan of God. How amazing.
Right.
That's absolutely amazing that God's redemption plan would already have been so pre-thought of and preordained before the beginning of the world. And so Jesus, he has just healed a blind man in the previous chapter number 9. We've talked about this already. And so he gets the stigma from the religious leaders of the day. You healed him on the Sabbath. Why did you say your sins be? Who sinned? He or his mom? And Jesus said that God might be glorified. And so now we find everything tumbling and coming into chapter number 10. And Jesus is speaking and he says this. He said, verily, verily, I say unto you, he who enters not in by the door into this the sheepfold, in the sheepfold, but climbs up some other way, the same as a thief and a robber. Now, let me clear the air a little bit, because we use this greatly to talk about heaven. So let's look at it for a little bit. Can a robber get to heaven?
No.
So it's probably not, although I feel it can be applicable and we can use it, but Jesus is speaking something greater than our minds are even fathoming and imagining. He's dealing with the religious leaders of the day who are not accepting him. And so he is trying to establish some things here. And John chapter number 9, verse number 41, someone to read that, just because without my glasses tonight, and it gives you good participation. Let's read that as we get ready to jump more into chapter number 10. John 9, 41.
Jesus said unto them, if ye were blind, ye should have no sin, but now ye say, we see. Therefore, your sin remaineth.
Wow, interesting. He's talking to these Pharisees. And Jesus said to them, if you say you're blind, you should have no sin. He said, there's a sin problem. So he starts out and he says, verily, verily. What does that mean? Does anyone know what an interpretation in our day? We probably wouldn't. I wouldn't come up to you and say, Brother Craig, barely, barely. Maybe what would I say? Does anyone know what words we would use in our language?
Surely.
What is it?
Again.
Truly. So it's a certainty that truly, here is Jesus. He's been accused of lying. He's been accused of doing things wrong. And so he hits him head on. He says, this is the truth. This is the truth. He said, if he enters not by the door of the sheepfold, but climbs in some other way, the same as a thief and a robber. what this means. Does anyone know what a sheepfold is? What's it looking at? What does a sheepfold look like when we look at it in a biblical perspective?
Normally they had like three walls with a door, or four walls with a door.
Right.
And normally they were made out of stone and dirt.
Very good. You're right. Some could even be caves. I'll talk more about that in a moment. So typically it was a wall that was 10 to 12 feet high. It was all four walls. There was a door that was an entrance and an exit. There was only one. And on top of the walls actually was planted thorns and thistles, so it would be very difficult to climb over because of these thorny bushes. In the wintertime, they would use caves. How do we know this? Is when we look back at 1 Samuel 23, verse number 4, it's a prime example of a cave that was used for sheep, particularly in the winter. Do you remember what's happening there in 1 Samuel 23? We read about something happening, some cutting going on. Someone's hiding out. So Saul is here in the cave, and his men says they could kill him, but David said, I won't touch God's anointed. And he even repents of what he did do. And so really what this is, it was a sheepfold. Most folks would say it was a sheepfold. And actually, the waste products from the sheep would cause a very hard layer that would be, a potassium nitrate that would deposit on there and almost make it a smooth, like, cement-type floor. And so that's what they would use during the winter time. And there was one entrance that led into the fold, and this is the interesting part. The person who would be the gate watcher or the keeper always wasn't the shepherd. In fact, sometimes the shepherd would go home. He was out with the sheep all the way during the day, and he had taken care of them, led them, provided for them, protected them. And so he puts them in the sheepfold, and there would be many people that would put the sheep in the sheepfold, and there would be one door, and the porter or the watcher would be there watching over these sheep. Now, it's his job. If you came any other way besides in through the entrance, you were a thief and a robber. Only the shepherd could come through the entrance because the one who was watching the entrance gave access to it. He said, you are the shepherd. You are the one who can come in. Now, you all may think, Melissa Bill, why do you spend so much time on this crazy stuff like that? Doesn't that just make it's very necessary for us to look deeply at that, because the next part is going to give us validation for why we need to know that. The Bible says, in verse number 2 through 4, but he that entereth in by the door is the shepherd of the sheep. To him the porter openeth, and the sheep heareth his voice, and he calleth his own sheep by name, and leadeth them out. And when he putteth forth his own sheep, he goeth before them, and the sheep follow them, for they know his voice. There is like so much information in these two verses. Let's jump into what we can figure out from this. So after at rest, the shepherd comes back. You know how you're going to do tomorrow morning at your job? You know, tomorrow morning you blink your eye and it will be here. So he went home, he's resting, he's coming back, and he's going to go in and get his sheep. But there's lots of sheep there. Lots of shepherds bring their sheep, and the porter takes care of them. How do they distinguish? Like, do they band them with colors or numbers, or how do they do this? Do they give them a fancy hairdo that everyone has their... Well, no, that's all crazy. The Word of God says this, that when the shepherd comes, his sheep knows his voice and follows him. Praise God that the sheep know his voice. They run unto him because they know his voice. There's something that's very important for us to know here, that with the shepherd and with the sheep, there is an intimate relationship. That's wonderful. That sheep, Sister Dietrich, knows that shepherd's voice because there's an intimate relationship.
Amen.
God doesn't just talk to us once in a while, but God speaks to us regularly. And we hear his voice. Praise God. So there should be in our life, when God begins to speak, There are lots of voices in the world, isn't there? There's lots of deceivers, there's lots of deception. But for the shepherd, when he speaks, the sheep that has been intimate with him knows his voice. That's encouraging to my heart today. It's encouraging for my walk with Christ that I know his voice. I want to know his voice. Where there are so many shepherds, let me know his voice. And then when we look at that shepherd, God doesn't just speak once in a while, but he speaks often. The Bible says that the sheep follows the shepherd. It's interesting, I think it was A.W. Tozer said this. He said, and I'm not going to quote it verbatim, but he said, sheep always walk in a set of footprints that are bigger than theirs. Isn't that interesting? Because wherever the sheep walks, the shepherds already walked and put a footprint there. And so wherever we walk as believers, each of us, we walk because the shepherd has led, and we walk in his footprints. How awesome tonight to think about that. It reminds me that Jesus has gone before us, and I've said this before. Jesus has gone before us, the Word of God says, that he has blazed the way, and with joy, he sat down at the right hand of God. He's already lived the life. He was tempted in every way, such as we are going to be tempted, yet he was without sin. And so he's already made the way to heaven so we can follow him. Wherever we go, we're stepping in footprints, amen, of someone who's greater. And it's so interesting as we look at this evening. Napoleon was one of the world's greatest leaders. And when you look at him, his name was Little Corporal. It was said of him that the reason why he got so much respect and did so much that was great is because he didn't command, but he led. And when it was out with his men, Brother Eli, they came to a river. He said to his men, Brother Justin, let's go across the river. They didn't move. So he said to his horse, giddy up. And the horse began to go across the river. And he said, follow your commander. And all the men followed him with joy to the other side because they followed the leader. They followed what he had commanded, but not only what he commanded, but what he exampled as well. Amen. Christ has called us to live a life, not that he has not lived, but one that he has lived and he calls us to live. Hallelujah. That's encouraging tonight. Amen. That wherever we go, whatever Christ has called us to do, he's already been there. But that's a challenge. Wow. That's a challenge to me as a pastor. That's a challenge to me as a husband. That's a challenge to me as a father. That's a challenge to me as a friend. That's a challenge to me as a chaplain. It's every area of my life. Because I cannot command people to live for Christ. But I can lead them. I can lead them. I cannot command, but I can lead. Paul said, follow me as I follow Christ. You know what I'm saying? I'm setting the example. I'm leading. Follow me. That is what the shepherd does. The sheep hear his voice. The Word of God says that they hear his voice as he calls his own by name and he leadeth them out. We are led this evening because of the voice of the shepherd and because we step in footprints that are bigger than ours. And this is what understanding everything that's transpired. Strategically, you read back verse number 41, chapter number 9. And Jesus has set this whole thing out. And he's talking about this sheepfold. The thieves and the robbers. Once again, it can't be heaven. But he's talking about something that is so important. The Bible says, and a stranger will they not follow, but will flee from him, for they know not the voice of the stranger. This parable spake Jesus unto them, but they understood not the things which he spoke to them. Sheep will not follow a stranger. They're not like a dog or a cat. They listen for the voice of the shepherd hand. And then they go. The words will not are very emphatic. It means they never will. So for you and I as believers, we must always follow the voice of the shepherd. And when it says in verse number 6, this parable spake Jesus unto them. This is very interesting. I am not a Greek, a Hebrew scholar, but I as I study what other men that are much smarter than me has given. It's interesting because John doesn't use the word parable in its original context in his gospel the way that Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John does. So as it's transferred, parable, it's the best word that they felt would fit that parable, but it's not the original that is used in the other three gospels, but it's actually a word called paromia, which means a figure of speech, an allegory, a speech which needs to be interpreted. So it's not a parable, which is an earthly story with a heavenly meaning, but it's an allegory. Let's figure out what he's talking about. And it's interesting to be able to try to figure this out. Without a knowledge of Jesus Christ and without salvation, without the Holy Spirit ministering to our hearts, we will never fully understand what God's word means. And so Jesus here is talking to these religious leaders of the day, and he's giving them, Brother Eli, all this information about the sheepfold. So what does it mean? The door of the sheepfold, it's not heaven or the church. Robbers can't get into heaven. But it's really a reference to the nation of Israel. And Jesus said, and other sheep I have which are not of this fold, them also I must bring, and they shall hear my voice, and there shall be one fold and one shepherd. Amen. The thieves and the robbers were the ones that were trying to steal the gospel message that Jesus Christ, Brother Justin, was coming to proclaim. They didn't want to hear this message. They didn't want to hear it, Brother Craig. They didn't want to hear the message that God's own Son had come down to this world. They didn't want him to uproot what they thought, Sister Dietrich, was their government. They didn't want him to uproot their religious tradition. And so here they are, and they're stuck in Judaism. They're stuck in this monotheistic God. Amen. And yes, we believe in a monotheistic God with a tripart nature. But they were stuck with the Torah and the Pentateuch. They couldn't get past the law. The law can't do anything to save you. It just leaves you guilty. And so Jesus was come that he could preach the message of salvation through the gospel of grace. But they didn't want to hear it. Jesus said, hey, this is the way it is. There is no, the law will not get you to heaven. You can try to dot all your I's and cross all your T's and live by the law and die and go to hell. It's another gospel. The gospel I preach to you is that there is no liberty under the law of God that allows you to come into the sheep. But when you enter in through the door, don't want to get ahead of myself, but he said, I am the door. I am the self-existing, the one and only door that you can enter in to the kingdom of heaven. So as we read this, knowing that he was the true shepherd, he's the true door. Let me ask you tonight if you can help me out. Now, I have a few things, and maybe there's other things. You know, my mind may not grasp everything. You may be able to bring more to the table than what I've come prepared with tonight. But to prove that he is the true shepherd, that he is the rightful shepherd of Israel, I mean, he definitely heals the beggar who's blind, and he does it so that he can speak to them. I want to heal your blind eyes, that you may see I am the Lord. If we look back at the Old Testament, what would give support, that's not even a complete word I want to use, what would give credibility to Jesus being the shepherd of the door? What fulfillment of the Old Testament do you think would say, wow, he is the door. He is the shepherd. All the other gospels are thieves and robbers. They don't have access. Can you think of anything? What did Isaiah say? And then in Matthew 1, Matthew reiterates it. He would be born of
a virgin.
A virgin. So Isaiah said, therefore the Lord himself shall give you a son. Behold, a virgin shall conceive and bear a son, and call his name Emmanuel. He was born of a virgin.
Do you think they believe that?
No, I don't. That's why they didn't accept him as a Savior.
Yeah.
What do you think?
Same thing.
What's something else? What was something else he would be born of? He'd be of the lineage of?
Of the Holy Ghost.
Of the Holy Ghost. But he would also be of the lineage of?
David.
David. So, in Luke, chapter number 1, verse number 32 says, he shall be great and shall be called the Son of the Highest, and the Lord God shall give unto him the throne of his father, David. So here it is. Once again, aside, now they may not have all these, but I'm saying this would be what Jesus is speaking to Israel. He came to Israel. And there, this religious leaders, and the struggle even was, and even some today. I have some dear Jewish friends. Boy, they're very, thank God for Messianic Jews.
Yeah.
But I know some Jews that, I've developed a great friendship with someone, and they are very, very, very offended by Messianic Jews. They celebrate all the feasts, but they don't celebrate anything about Jesus. When Hanukkah comes, they don't want to talk about Jesus and the birth of Christ at Christmas. But the Lord's given us a good relationship. The Lord's helping us. But Jesus was conquering this even way back then. Spirit's still around. He would also be of the rod of the stem of Jesse. He would be born of the tribe of Judah in Bethlehem. We know that he fulfilled that promise. So everything, and he would be without sin. Everything about him was a fulfillment. Wait, has anybody else been able to fulfill these things? Anybody else?
No.
No. He says, I'm the Lord. Anyone else coming through is a thief and a robber.
Yeah.
But my sheep, when they come to the saving knowledge of me, they hear my voice. They know who I am. Because the Holy Ghost has brought to life their mind and what was dead in them. This would be going on. I'm speaking as they experience salvation. But he was coming to present himself as the shepherd. So really that's what everything is all about. Remember we're given chapters and verses, and so it's broke up. So just because there's a break between chapter number 9 and chapter number 10 doesn't mean that there's not continuity with what's going on there. In fact, the reference that John gives to us, behold the Lamb of God, who taketh away the sins of the world. He was the shepherd, but he is the lamp. And I just find that interesting tonight.
I have a question.
Yes.
What weren't there Sadducees and Pharisees there when John baptized Jesus and God spoke?